Good morning, students. Here I will discuss the designing digital IIR filters. So here, to design the digital IIR filters, we have one indirect method already discussed in the previous sessions. That is, from analog filter design only, we can determine the digital filter design. That means here it involves three basic steps. The first one is, from the digital filter specifications, we should convert the analog filter specifications. So here, from the analog filter specifications, by using either Butterworth filter or Chebyshev filter designing steps, we should find out the transfer function of the analog filter. That is indicated as HA of S. Now here, the third one is, from HA of S, that is the analog transfer function, we should convert that HA of S into the digital filter transfer function, actually denoted as H of Z. So here we should convert HA of S to the H of Z. So here the second one, that means from the analog filter specifications, we should find out the analog transfer function. This one is discussed already in the previous sessions, Butterworth filter designing steps and Chebyshev filter designing steps. Kindly follow this. If you understand this only, you can understand the next part. Okay, now here, of course, now we have the HA of S from the second step. But now we should convert that HA of S into the H of Z. To do this, here S is converted into the Z. That means we should concentrate on S plane in the analog filter, Z plane in the digital filter. So here, of course, we have an idea. S plane means it consists of two axes. One is the sigma real axis. Another one is J omega imaginary axis. Since S is equal to sigma plus J omega, that is the complex one, that is represented in the form, rectangular form. Now coming to the Z plane. Z plane, it consists of two axes. One is the real axis, another one is the imaginary axis. That Z is denoted as R into e power J omega. So that is in polar form. This one also complex quantity. That means here we should map this S to Z. That means we should map this S plane to Z plane. So okay, here in the S plane we have the reference axis, that is the J omega axis. As in the same way, in the Z plane we have the reference circle, that is the unique circle. So here, if you map this S plane to Z plane, right? So here we should map this J omega axis into the unit circle in the Z plane. So that means here, like this. So this is the S plane and this is the Z plane. So now here, this J omega axis should map into the unit circle in the Z plane. Okay, it's okay. Now, so this is the first point. So here, usually for analog filters, we are using the symbol for frequency is like this, omega. For Z, so normal omega. Okay, so remember this one. So that means here, the next point is, the stable analog filter should map into the stable digital filter. What is the stability here? Actually, the analog filter is stable when and only when the all the poles are should lie all the poles should lie in the left half plane of the S plane. Already this one is discussed in the signals and systems, Laplace transforms and Z transforms. So just you may recall that one later. Okay, right. So now here remember this point. Stability means poles in the S plane, all the poles should lie in the left half plane. In the S plane. In the Z plane, all the poles should be lie in the inside of the unit circle. Okay. So that's why here to map the stable analog filter to the stable digital filter, the left half plane of the S plane should map into the inside of the unit circle in the Z plane. So okay, from this, of course, we can say like this also, another point, that is to map the unstable analog filter to the unstable digital filter, the right half plane of the S plane should map into the outside of the unit circle in the Z plane. Okay, right. Now, these two are the desirable properties of effective conversion technique to design digital IIR filters from analog filters. Okay, now coming to the here different methods for digitizing the analog filter into a digital filter. That means we have the analog filter transfer function now from the analog specifications, analog filter specifications. From that analog filter design, you should get the digital filter design. That means if you digitize this analog nature, then you can get the digital filter, obviously. Now, we have the different methods here, but in our syllabus, we focus only on these two methods. One is the impulse invariant transformation, another one is bilinear transformation. Okay, now, so here the procedure is there. So, I just say here a little bit fast. Here, I should complete this one. I don't want to take the much time. So, in this video. So, here if you have any doubt, so ask me personally. Okay. Now, here, design of IIR filter using impulse invariance technique. So, this is nothing but a very simple one. That means, so here we have the analog filter impulse response. What is that? H of t. From the H of t, we should get the H of n. That is the impulse response of the digital filter. So that means here simply take the some sampled version of the H of t. Then you can get the H of n. This is the logic here. So that's why here the unit impulse response H of n of digital filter is the sampled version of the impulse response of analog filter. So firstly here just concentrate on the Z transform of H of n, that is H of Z is equal to summation n 0 to infinity H of n Z power minus n. Of course take the causal system. So then here that means to map the S plane to Z plane actually, or to map the Laplace transform into the Z transform here, we should consider this equation. What is that? Z is equal to e power s capital T, right? So here that means here if you take a H of T equation, that is the Laplace transform equation, that means H of s, of course Laplace transform of H of T is the H of s, that is equal to integration 0 to infinity H of T e power minus s t dt. There if you substitute T is equal to nt, and then if you simplify, and then if you map that one with the H of n, that means you know that the sample version of H of T is nothing but H of n, means if you we have to substitute it, that means nt in the place of T, that means H of nt is equal to H of T, H of n capital T is equal to H of T, like that. There is a one procedure. So after particular simplification, so you can get the formula like this. What that is nothing but Z is equal to e power st, right? That means this is the equation which gives the mapping between the S plane to Z plane. That means z is equal to e power s t. Here, I am substituting that equation here, h of z is equal to h of z at z is equal to e power st, that is equal to summation h of n, in the place of z substitute this one, e power minus st n, this one, okay. So, okay, here, now, see here, what is s and what is z? So, now here take, we know that s is sigma plus j omega, observe the notation here, analog frequency notation. And here z is equal to r into e power j omega. Observe this one. This is the digital filter notation, omega frequency. So now here, if you substitute these two values in this equation, z is equal to e power st. So substitute z here and substitute s here, and then e power sigma plus j omega t is nothing but e power sigma t into e power j omega t. Now if you compare these two here, we know that r is nothing but e power sigma t. In this, e power j omega is equal to e power j omega t. That means here the digital frequency is equal to analog frequency into capital T. So here we can get the two equations here. One is r is equal to e power sigma t. Another one is digital frequency is equal to analog frequency into capital T. So that means here, what is the r here? Actually, the magnitude of the z. What is the omega here? The phase angle of the z. What is the sigma here? Real part of the s. What is the omega here? The imaginary part of the s. So that means here we can conclude that the magnitude value of z is nothing but the real part of the s value, that means e power sigma t. In the same way, here the phase angle omega is nothing but here the imaginary part, what is that? Omega into capital T. So here the real part of the analog pole is, you can say like this also, the real part of the analog pole, that means analog pole means you can get the roots like this, s minus s1, s minus s2, like that in the transfer function of the analog filter. That means h of s is equal to 1 by or some constant divided by s minus s1 into s minus s2 and so on. Like that means here s minus s1 indicates the that here pole at s is equal to s1. So that's why here the real part of the analog pole is nothing but the radius of the z plane pole. The imaginary part of the analog pole is the angle of the z plane pole. Understand? Here from these two equations. So here these are the conclusions. The real part of the analog pole, the real part of the analog pole is nothing but radius of the z plane pole. This is R. So what is the magnitude? Of course, that is nothing but the radius of the circle here, actually in the z plane. Okay, so now here this is the meaning. Now the imaginary part of the analog pole is the angle of the z plane pole. Okay, now here is the example. So this is a diagram figure which indicates that the mapping between the s plane into the z plane. So now we know that the reference axis is here on j omega axis. The reference one is here, the unit circle here with the radius 1. That means r is equal to 1 here. That's why it is said to be unit circle 1. But here different phase angles are there. Like this. Like this. That means 0 to 360 degrees. Okay. So here, in the here also in the s-plane, on j omega axis, sigma is equal to 0. Okay, now, so see this, the first point, first case is, if suppose sigma 0, that means j omega axis only. So here if you substitute sigma 0, what is the r value? 1. So that means, in the s-plane, if real part is 0, now what is the r value here? 1. That means z is equal to 1 here, right? And 1 means here the magnitude is 1. Radius is 1. So now here, look here. So that means if sigma 0, then r is equal to 1. That means here the mapping is between the, like this, from explains J omega axis to the jet plane unit circle. Okay, so here from this equation you just substitute sigma, then find R and then map, do the map here like this. Okay, now understand. So if you take any pole on this, if you have any pole on this, all the poles are mapped on the unit circle in the jet plane only. That is the meaning here. Okay, right. So this is the example. So look here carefully. So now here, see this. If sigma less than 0, then from this equation, R is e power sigma t, sigma less than 0. This exponential function also gives the value less than 1. That means R is less than 1. That means if you consider any poles, that means if that real part of the pole, real part of the pole is less than 0. So like this, that means minus 2 plus 3j like that. So that means here like this, minus 2 means sigma less than 0 like this. And that means all the poles are lying at the left half plane. Okay. So these poles, all the poles should map into the inside the unit circle only. Right. So from this the conclusion is all S plane poles with negative real parts map to jet plane poles inside the unit circle. That means stable analog poles are mapped to stable digital poles. This is the conclusion 2. Now the third one. If sigma less than sigma greater than 0, then R is greater than 1 from this equation. That means here all S plane poles with positive real parts map to jet plane poles outside the unit circle. That means unstable analog poles are mapped to the unstable digital poles. Okay, so now here, so see here, the J omega axis is mapped to the unit circle. That means here, obviously we thought like that. What is that? So, one-to-one mapping. That means here is a one pole. This is mapped to the pole in the jet plane only. So, but actually, one-to-one mapping done here actually, but here many to one mapping has to be done here. So why? Because what is the reason here? Why not the one to one mapping? Why only this one is many to one mapping? That means many poles in the S plane are mapped to single pole in the jet plane. Understood? Now see this example. That if S1, we have the so many poles. I'm taking here two poles. For example, if one pole is at sigma plus j omega, another pole is at sigma plus j omega plus 2 pi by t. So here, if you substitute this S1 in this equation, so the mapping between S and Z equation, what is that? Z is e power st here. I can get like this. If I substitute S2 here, that means here the same real part, but imaginary part is varied. Now here, look here, e power sigma t, e power j omega t plus e power j 2 pi. Of course, you know that e power j 2 pi is 1. Then you can get the again e power sigma t, e power j omega t as in the case Z1. That means here Z1 is equal to Z2. For different poles in the S plane, you can get the only one pole. So, this is nothing but many to one mapping. This is the drawback here. So, see the example in this figure. We have the poles here. One pole is here, another one is here, another one is here like that. See here. So, here this is sigma axis. So, here I am taking pi by t value here, 3 pi by t value here, minus pi by t value, minus 3 pi by t. Here, the range of omega between, j omega, that means this one, y axis, omega. So analog omega, analog frequency, the range is between pi by t to minus pi by t. That is said to be here primary strip. So okay, here so one pole is in the primary strip. So another poles are located at out of the primary strip. That is, one is at this one, another one is at this one. If you observe and then if you calculate the Z1, Z2, Z3 values, you can get the pole here or location here only in the Z plane. Okay, right? Here. That means here many poles are mapped to single pole in the Z plane. So that means here we have the so many poles, but it will appear like a single pole. So this is said to be here aliasing. That means here the main drawback is this one. Here one more important point is, to avoid this aliasing, all the poles should be located in between this range pi by t to minus pi by t. That is called as primary strip. Okay, now so this is the point, these are the important points here. There are an infinite number of S-plane poles that map to the same location in the Z plane. This is the main disadvantage of impulse invariant mapping. The S-plane poles having imaginary parts greater than pi by t are less than minus pi by t cause aliasing when sampling analog signals. The analog poles will not be aliased by the impulse invariant mapping if they are confined to the S-plane's primary strip. Right? Clear? Now, so going to the another one, that is from this you can get an idea, right? So what is the range of omega here to avoid the aliasing? So, and after that, how to map this H of S to the H of Z here. For this here, very simple example, that means if I take the analog filter transfer function is summation of the all first order poles like this. That means C1 by S minus P1 plus C2 by S minus P2 plus C3 by S minus P3 and so on. That means here, from the analog filter transfer function, you can convert that transfer function into this form. That means summation of all individual first order functions. That means you have to apply the partial fractions. Okay, right? So, do use the partial fractions for HA of S and then convert that HA of S into this form. Okay, so here this is the form here. Now, to find the HA of T here, apply the inverse Laplace transform. Now you can get like this, summation CK e power PKT. Of course, you know that inverse Laplace transform of 1 by S minus A is nothing but e power minus S plus A. 1 by S plus A is nothing but e power minus AT. T greater than 0. From that equation here is a minus PK in the place of A. Substitute here e power PKT. Okay, like this. And then now sample this HA of T, that is periodically at T is equal to N into capital T. Capital T is the sampling period here. Now H of N is equal to HA of N capital T. Now, so here HA of N capital T means here in the place of T substitute N capital T. Now from the H of N, find the H of Z. That means by applying the Z transform, then you can get the like this. What is that? H of Z is equal to here summation. There is a formula, substitute H of N here. That means we can get the two summations, one for K, one for N. And then here, so separate the K summation here and then summation N e power PK T Z power minus 1 whole power N. Separate the N here and then now. So, you know that summation n 0 to infinity a power n is nothing but 1 by 1 minus a z inverse. From that equation, here the answer is 1 by 1 minus a is here e power p k t z inverse. Okay, from that equation, you can get like this. That means summation c k by this one. Okay, so now here, from this, what is the conclusion here? H of s is this one. This is the form. Now, this form is transformed into digital filter transfer function h of z like this. That means here simply in the place of pk, you just take e power pkt z inverse. Okay, simple one. That means by using either Butterworth filter or Chebyshev filter design, so you can get one h a of s. So for that h a of s, first do the partial fractions and then so get in this form. Now simply in the place of pk, you just substitute e power pk capital T z power minus 1. That is nothing but h of z. Okay, very simple one. Okay, now this one is for low sampling periods actually. So for high sampling rates, you just use this formula. So just multiply this one by the t. Okay, now here, so due to the presence of aliasing here, this impulse invariant method is appropriate for low pass and band pass filter designing only, not for the high pass filters. Okay, keep it in mind. This is the main important point here. So okay, here what is the disadvantage here? So aliasing. So many poles are in the S plane are mapped into the single pole in the Z plane. That means you should take the here values, the poles, imaginary value should be in the primary strip only. That means in between pi by t to minus pi by t. After calculating t here, so here you should keep this point here. Okay, in your mind, that is that pole imaginary value should be in the minus pi by t to plus pi by t only. Then only we can consider this method. Okay, so now, so these are the different steps here to design the digital filter using impulse invariance method. So here first given values are digital filter specifications. So now first choose the capital T value and determine the analog frequencies. So already this one also given, otherwise we may choose the T value. So this is our choice. Now, so determine the analog frequencies by using these formulas in this impulse invariance method. Since we have one relation between digital frequency and analog frequency, that is omega is equal to analog frequency into capital T. From that here, from the given digital frequencies, omega P by TP, passband frequency by TP is nothing but analog frequency. Stopband frequency, digital frequency divided by TS is nothing but stopband analog frequency. So now here design analog filter HA of S using any one of the two prototypes. So here from the specifications, analog specifications, find the HA of S value here. From the analog specifications, find the analog filter HA of S here by using either Butterworth filter or Chebyshev filter. And after getting HA of S, so by using partial fraction expansion method, find the HA of S. That means it should be in the form like this. So here, like C1 by S minus P1 plus C2 by S minus P2 and so on like this. After getting this one, so simply in the place of PK, substitute this one. Then you can get the H of J. So this is nothing but digital filter, digital IIR filter transfer function from the digital filter specifications. Okay, here this is nothing but digital filter design using impulse invariance method. Okay, now the second method, that is the bilinear transformation. So what is the advantage here? 1-to-1 mapping. But in the previous case, what is the disadvantage? Many to one mapping. But that is here we overcome that problem here. That is here 1-to-1 mapping is there between S plane to Z plane, that and hence you can avoid the aliasing of frequency components. And of course these are the three important points already discussed. That means mapping, that means it transforms the J omega axis into the unit circle in the Z plane only once. All points in the left half plane of S are mapped inside the unit circle in the Z plane. That means stable poles are mapped into stable analog poles are mapped into the stable digital poles, and all the points in the right half plane of S are mapped into the corresponding points outside the unit circle in the Z plane. That means unstable poles in the analog filter should be mapped into the unstable poles in the digital filter. Okay, that's okay. So now coming to the here design. So here the method is, so bilinear transformation method means here one-to-one mapping, of course. Now here, for example, the system function, the particular analog filter transfer function is in the form like B by S plus A, like this. Then, so you just simplify this one here. So this an approach is that trapezoidal formula is involved here actually. So based on that here, we just convert this H of S into the H of Z. That means, suppose H of S is in the form like B by S plus A, we can easily convert this one into the H of Z by using this approach. Finally, you can get like this. What is that? H of Z is equal to B by 2 by T 1 minus Z inverse by 1 plus Z inverse plus A. That means if you observe this one in the place of S, you can get like this. That means wherever if you have the, that means S in the H of S, then you just place 2 by T 1 minus Z inverse by 1 plus Z inverse, then you can get the H of Z. Okay, that is the method here. So what is the here, how can you get this H of Z? This one is indicated here actually. That is you just go through this, and if you have doubt, ask me. Okay, right? So these are the different steps. The main point is here, H of S is converted into H of Z by placing S is equal to 2 by T 1 minus Z inverse by 1 plus Z inverse. This relationship between S and Z is known as bilinear transformation. Okay, so now see this here. After simplifying this S equation like this, separating real and imaginary terms, since S is sigma plus J omega, so I can get sigma and omega like this. If I substitute I'm substituting R is equal to 1, then I can get the sigma 0 and omega is equal to, look here, so S is equal to this one. So from this, simplify this equation, substitute Z is equal to R into e power j omega, and now S is equal to sigma plus j omega. Simplify like this, then compare these two. So that means real value is this one, imaginary value is this one. Now if you substitute R is equal to 1 here, sigma is equal to 0. We know that sigma 0 means J omega axis in the S plane, that should be mapped to the unit circle in the Z plane. So it obeys the condition actually. And then here if you observe the omega, imaginary part, that is nothing but here like this. That means here also we should substitute R is equal to 1. So if R is 1 here, simplify this equation, then you can get the omega, analog frequency like this, 2 by T tan omega by 2. This is very important equation. Remember this, omega is equal to 2 by T tan omega by 2. From this, omega is equal to 2 tan inverse omega T by 2. This is the relation between digital frequency and analog frequency in the bilinear transformation, whereas in the impulse invariant method, the relation between omega, digital frequency, and analog frequency omega is nothing but omega is equal to analog frequency into capital T. But here, what is the relationship between omega and this omega? 2 by T into tan digital frequency by 2 is nothing but analog frequency. Remember this difference. Excuse me. Okay. Now coming to the here disadvantage. Okay, actually. So here in the impulse invariant method, what is the disadvantage? Aliasing effect. So here in the bilinear transformation, what is the drawback? We should know about that. So here, if you observe this relationship, omega is equal to 2 by t tan omega by 2. So from this, if for all values of theta, we know that tan theta is theta. Now tan omega by 2 is nothing but omega by 2. So omega is equal to omega by 2. Then you can get omega is equal to omega t, as in the same way, impulse invariant method. That means here there is a linear relationship between the analog frequency and the digital frequency. Actually, from this, that is the conclusion. But here, for low frequencies only, so it agree that one. Okay, so that means, but here for high values of omega, tan theta is not equal to theta, then omega is 2 by t tan omega by 2. That means here the linear one is changed into the non-linear one. So what is the conclusion here? The relation between analog and digital frequency is linear for low frequencies only, but non-linear for high frequencies. So what is the effect here for this statement here? We just discuss here. So see the relationship between omega and omega figure here. This is omega t and this is omega pi. Now here this one is nothing but, what is that? This is omega, this is omega t. So this is 0 to pi range, and I am taking here like this. Now here if you consider this one, this is a linear nature, but here based on this equation, so if you draw the particularly relay, what is that, omega and this omega t graph, you can get like this. Observe here, for low frequencies this is linear, but for higher frequencies it is non-linear. Okay, now see this two wonderful characteristics. One is the magnitude response, another one is the phase response. Okay, so here due to this linear nature, non-linear relationship between this digital frequency and the analog frequency, suppose if analog transfer function is in the form like this band pass filter, certain bands, pass bands are there here. So see here, these are seems to be like a, what is that, uniform distance. So bandwidth is similar for all cases. So if you apply this one to this characteristic, you can get like this, right? That means if you convert this analog transfer function into the digital transfer function based on this equation, what is that? Based on this equation, what is that? Omega is equal to 2 by t tan omega by 2. So you can get like this. That means there is no linear proportionality. That means here bandwidths are equal. Okay. But now here see this, as the frequency increases, the bandwidth is going to be 0. So this is a drawback here. And now coming to this one, this is about the magnitude response only. Coming to the phase response, if the phase is linear like this, of course you know that the magnitude response is constant and the phase is linear like that. I take the same way here. So now take the linear. Now here apply here, you can get like this. That means for low frequencies here, what is the phase, and for high frequencies what is this? So there is a non-linear relationship between the non-linear nature of the phase response. Actually the phase response should be linear, but due to this the phase response of the digital filter is non-linear. So this is the drawback here. So now here the same points here, for low frequencies the relationship between omega and omega are linear, the digital filter have the same amplitude response as the analog filter. Okay, for high frequencies the relationship between analog frequency and digital frequency becomes non-linear, that means as in figure 1, and distortion is introduced in the frequency scale of the digital filter to that of the analog filter. This is known as the warping effect. Remember, this is very important question. What is warping effect? Okay, so now write like this. For low frequencies, there is no variations, but with high frequencies, the relationship between omega and omega becomes non-linear and may chance to distort but distort the characteristics. Like means the distortion is introduced in the frequency scale of the digital filter. This is nothing but warping effect. So what is the influence of this warping effect? So on amplitude response and phase response. So discussed in figure 2 and discussed in figure 3. What is that? By considering an analog filter with a number of pass bands centered at regular intervals, the derived digital filter will have same number of pass bands, but the center frequencies and bandwidth of high frequency pass band will tend to reduce disproportionately, like this. Okay. Now coming to the phase response, by considering an analog filter with the linear phase response, but the phase response of the derived digital filter will be non-linear, like this. Okay, this linear, this non-linear. So this is very important. So read well, right? So now what is the pre-warping effect? So how can we eliminate this warping effect? Means by using pre-warping the analog filter, we can eliminate this warping effect. So here, by what is the how can you pre-warp the analog frequency means? So here, from this formula, omega is 2 by 2 tan omega by 2. So here in the first point and first point here, that means digital filter specifications are given. Actually, we should convert the digital filter specifications into analog filter specifications. There only you should pre-warp the frequencies like this. That means, so analog digital frequency is omega p. So instead of using linear relationship, what is that? Omega is equal to omega t, like that. But here use this frequency, that means 2 by t tan omega p, this frequency by 2, digital frequency by 2. Use this formula, then you can get the analog frequency. So use the stop band frequency here, digital frequency, then you can get the stop and analog frequency. So carefully listen here. In the case of impulse invariant method, use the formula omega p is nothing but omega digital frequency by t, actually, right? So here, 1 minute, look here, this one, omega p by t, omega s by t is omega s. But here, in this case, use this equation. That means tan omega p by 2, 2 by t is nothing but this one, tan omega s by 2, 2 by t is this one. By using this one, so pre-warping will be done, then you can easily eliminate the warping effect. Okay, so now here, these are the steps to design digital filter using bilinear transformation technique. So digital filter specifications are given. So from the given specifications, we should find out the analog frequencies. So these are called as here pre-warping frequencies. Use this formula. So as I said before, so now design the analog filter HAS using any one of the two methods from the analog filter specifications. Now choose the sampling rate of the digital filter T here. So now use this equation 2 by T 1 minus Z inverse by 1 plus Z inverse. So in the place of S, in equation HA of S, then you can get the H of J. So very simple one, H of J is equal to HA of S at S is equal to this equation. Okay, so these are the simple points. So okay, here, so in the two methods, actually in the previous, in the, what is that, former method, impulse invariant method, this is the bilinear transformation technique. So just follow the steps here. But here the third point is very important. What is that? Already discussed in the previous video sessions. That means we should find out the HA of S from the analog filter specifications, either the Butterworth filter or Chebyshev filter. Okay, so together here, so we will take one problem and then I will submit the another video to do that, how to do the problem here. Okay, right? So okay, so follow all this, read well, read number of times, then only you can get the clear idea. Okay, thank you.